Tonight, in the first of three special programmes on the media, I'm investigating the revolution transforming newspapers.
The world is changing, and it's up to newspapers to adapt to that.
Our changing lifestyles and the economic slump are hitting the daily paper where it hurts.
The sums simply don't add up. These are not economic businesses that we are running.
Circulations are falling and advertisers are taking their business elsewhere.
We are seeing a real downturn in things like property advertising, recruitment advertising.
Fleet Street is fighting back with free commuter papers.
Would you pay any money for it?
No.
No, all right. And new online services.
Newspapers need to deliver a very strong web and digital presence.
But there's a big problem with the internet.
There's probably only about one website in the UK developed by newspapers that is profitable.
In these tough times, no paper is safe.
There's going to be consolidation, adaption and extinction. There will be blood on the streets.
Can newspapers survive the media revolution? I've worked in and out of newspapers all my life, doing everything from fashion writing to restaurant reviewing. I've been an editor, a journalist and a columnist, but I've never done this job before. This morning I'm doing my bit to get the news out to the nation on a South London paper round.
There's a dog in this house. Yeah, start barking.
It's not without hazards, but it's worth it, because I'm delivering to a dying breed, the great British newspaper reader. 10 years ago, there were 10 newspaper rounds in this area. Today, there are just 5. Less and less people, it seems, share my love of newsprint. I want to find out the extent of the problems facing the newspaper industry and see what, if any, solutions there are.
Good Telegraph.
Evening, Paul.
Well, okay.
Newspapers have never been less popular. Over the last 10 years, our favourite dailies have lost 2.25 million readers. Worst hit of the tabloids has been The Mirror. It's lost over 750,000 readers. That's equivalent to the population of Leeds. Even Britain's most popular daily, The Sun, has lost over 400,000 readers. The broadsheets haven't fared much better. The Guardian is down 10% and The Telegraph has lost 17% of its readers. Most affected are the Sundays. Last year alone, over 500,000 people stopped buying a Sunday paper. Falling circulations mean less money through the till. And newspapers' other main source of income is also drying up. This is a month's worth of national newspapers, thousands of pages of news, features, sport and comment. But watch this. Look how the pile shrinks when you remove the advertising. That's how lucrative it is to the newspaper industry, even in an economic downturn. Sir Martin Sorrell's companies place more adverts in newspapers than any other.
We buy about $70 billion a metre around the world, which is about a 25% market share. So one in four ads that you see in newspapers or magazines probably comes from us.
As readers have moved elsewhere, so have advertisers, leaving newspapers with a double cash headache.
Over the last 10 years, I think it is, circulations have declined by about 20%. And advertising revenues have similarly declined by about 20%.
Advertisers have found new places online. Websites like Facebook, MSN and MySpace all display ads that you used to see in newspapers. It's a problem for the entire industry, but local papers are hardest hit.
Around 3/4 of our revenue comes from advertising. It is advertising which pays for the entire business. It sustains our infrastructure. Our advertising revenue in total was down by 23%. And that's straight off the bottom line, effectively. So we've got to find ways of sustaining the activity.
classified ads, the traditional staple of the local papers, are also moving online.
If you look at the decline in classified advertising, literally in the last year or so, I mean, you're talking about 15, 20, 25, 30% in property areas, in real estate property, in financial services, in automobiles. These new forms of online advertising have had a tremendous and drastic influence on the profitability of the old.
We're beginning to see what these dramatic drops in income mean for newspapers as businesses.
It's pretty hard to record because it's happening so quickly just how many job losses there are. But over the past few weeks, we've recorded 500 journalists lost their jobs, several thousand media and editorial workers, 55 titles closed, 45 offices closed, editions being cut back, pagination being cut back. It's pretty grim for journalists across the whole of the print industry.
Next month, my newspaper, The Independent, is moving into this building to share office space and backroom staff with rival newspaper, The Daily Mail. It's a revolutionary, cost-cutting move that would have been unthinkable in the past.
Fleet Street in the City of London. Slow-moving traffic masks one of the beating pulses of the world.
In its heyday, Fleet Street must have been one of the most exciting places on earth, packed with newspaper workers from the journalists and copy takers to typesetters and printers. And when I started here as a fashion writer in the 1970s, the place was still buzzing. For many journalists back then, Elvino's wine bar was like a second office. So where better to come to pick the brains of one of the industry's elder statesmen?
When I was 14 and 1 week old, I got into Reuters and got a job as a messenger boy and, of course, became managing editor of the Daily Mirror, editor of the Daily Express, launched the Daily Star, editor of the News of the World.
Derek knows the history of this street better than anyone, and he says newspapers have come through revolutions before.
They survived everything that has been there to destroy them. After World War II, you had a great surge in communication with radio. Mm-hmm. Then you had television. Mm-hmm. I was a young sub-editor on the Daily Express in 1961, I think, and a memo came around, do not pay too much attention to this new commercial television. I feel it is a passing phase and will never catch on with the public.
Speed, obviously, is the key to good news coverage, plus smoothness of operation.
Newspapers resisted change for decades, but by the mid-80s, they had to modernise.
Major changes are taking place in Fleet Street.
A proprietor called Rupert Murdoch had plans to revolutionise newspaper production by moving his papers out of Fleet Street into new computerised offices in Wapping.
Well, of course, Wapping changed our world forever. The American papers, Japanese, Europe, had been using computerised production for years, but the unions here in Britain wouldn't allow us to touch computerisation.
The standoff between the proprietor and the print unions threatened to tear the country apart.
Are you out to destroy the two print unions?
No, I'm out to preserve my newspapers for the two and for the people who do work for them.
We put that
ahead of everything.
There was only ever going to be one winner. Today, Rupert Murdoch is the most famous and powerful media baron on the planet. Unsurprisingly, he remains a big believer in the news industry.
It's the words that count. Now, the words well written, the idea is interesting. Is the news first there? It still excites me to be first, to have a scoop or something, you know?
From his global headquarters in New York, he controls some of the world's best-selling and most influential newspapers, including The Sun and The Times in Britain, and his most recent acquisition in America, The Wall Street Journal.
The Wall Street Journal is one of the great newspaper brands of the world and one of the great newspapers of the world, and we intend to make it a lot greater. And we think we've done so already, but it's very much just a work in progress. And we're the only newspaper in America in the last 12 months that's gone up in circulation, albeit by only 1 or 2%.
Murdoch is bucking the trend at home in the UK too.
You know, the London Sun, for instance, circulation is greater today than it was a year ago. I've got to tell you, it's less than it was 10 years ago, but it is greater than it was a year ago.
The Sun is the only major British newspaper not to have lost readers over the last year. It must be doing something right. I've penetrated Fortress Wapping Security to have a word with the Sun's managing editor.
Hello, Janet. Welcome to the Sun.
Hi, Graham.
Off to you.
Thank you. Rare bit of chivalry. So how are you bucking circulation, Trent?
It's the old thing of fantastic journalism. Great stories, great campaigns.
Well, you would say that.
Well, you ask the question, I'm giving you the answer.
All right.
And don't take my word for it. At the British Press Awards, we won more awards than any other newspaper.
What The Sun has also done is cut its cover price compared to its main rival, The Mirror.
Now, if you're such a strong product, why slash the price?
Well, slashing the price is perhaps a bit evocative from you, Janet. What we're doing is giving our readers the best possible value for money while maintaining a very profitable newspaper, which is what The Sun is.
Despite the downturn, Rupert Murdoch has actually increased investment in editorial and production. Last year, he moved the printing part of his operation out of Wapping and built this new press outside London. It prints The Sun, The Times, The Telegraph and The London Paper, and it prints them faster and better than ever before.
A single press in Wapping would print typically a 120-page tabloid newspaper at 30,000 copies an hour and would have about 40% of those pages in full colour. These presses that we've now got can produce 86,000 copies an hour, so nearly three times as many newspapers, but in full colour. In a typical week, we're printing in a region of 23 million newspapers, which actually, when you add that up to a year, is about
23 million is one newspaper for every three people in Britain,
yeah,
roughly.
Exactly.
This technology doesn't come cheap, but in the long term, News International says it will save money because it makes printing more economical.
Wow, that's really impressive. This is the largest printing press in the world. Outside, it's as quiet as a cathedral. Inside, what a racket. But this is cutting-edge technology. It delivers newspapers so quickly and with full colour throughout. Now, if they can't make money printing newspapers like this, there's no hope for Fleet Street.
Rupert Murdoch isn't the only man with new printing presses. Other papers have also invested in new technology in the hope that by making their papers full colour, they can keep readers and charge advertisers more for their ads. But city analysts say things haven't gone according to plan.
Thank you. With the advertising market coming off, the only avenue open to them in order to get a decent return on that investment is to put up cover prices. And so there's been a growing trend towards cover prices going up. So, for example, the Sunday Times has just gone to £2. The Daily Independent has gone up to £1.
Fiddling with price is a dangerous business. Too high and you could lose so many readers, you end up making less money. One way to keep them loyal is to bribe them with freebies.
Clearly by a giveaway, be it a book or be it a CD, you boost your circulation numbers, and then when you talk to the media buyers, you can show an inflated circulation number. So you kind of get a payback through your advertising.
The Sunday newspapers are masters of the free giveaway. Every week they come up with something different. Guides to garden birds, CDs, DVDs, free flights. They'll give you almost anything as long as you keep buying their newspaper. When pop group McFly set up their own record company, they decided that instead of releasing their new album in the traditional way, they would give it away free with a newspaper.
you know, the Mail on Sunday were really at the forefront of giving music away free. You know, they did it with Prince, I think it was exactly a year before we did it, and which was obviously a huge success.
The paper won't say how much it paid McFly for the deal, but the boost to sales was obvious.
I think their normal circulation is 2.1 million with the Mail on Sunday, and on that day it did 2.4. For us, an extra, not only 2.4 million people had our album, but an extra 300,000 people went and got it. It was so encouraging.
The deal meant McFly reached almost 2.5 million listeners in a single weekend, and the paper got 300,000 more readers.
For them, it's hopefully got the same effect as it had for us, having our fans, often which are in their teenage years, going out and buying a paper that they probably wouldn't normally buy.
Offsetting cover price losses with advertising gains is a trick that has been used for decades, but today a new breed of paper is taking it to the extreme. Because they cost nothing, free sheets are picked up by huge numbers of commuters across the country. This means papers like Metro can deliver a lucrative new group of consumers to advertisers.
We've identified there were 11 million people actually travelling every day. These are people in full-time work, actually, on public transport, who are not getting or not reading a newspaper. So that's where Metro has filled that gap.
And you've targeted the young people who have disposable income, and that's what's attractive to advertisers.
Absolutely, because it's very difficult to get hold of those young people. They're low watchers of TV, they don't tend to read newspapers, they're actually the low listeners as well of radio.
By keeping its circulation high and its costs low, Metro manages to make money even though it's free. But is that good for the industry as a whole? Free sheets have been accused of dumbing down content.
What I find extraordinary about Metro is you call it a newspaper, but there's very little actual news in it.
No, it's rubbish, that. There's 55% of it is news, so there's only 45% advertising. The rest is all news.
According to Steve, Metro is full of news, information and content. But if it's that good, would people actually pay money for it? Hi, I know you're in a hurry. I just need to ask you, would you actually pay for Metro?
No.
No, why not?
Well, it's just junk reading.
Junk reading, OK. You got it for nothing?
Yeah.
Would you pay money for it?
Probably not.
Not?
No.
No? No.
Pay money?
Probably not, no.
Why not?
Why put it on the screen?
Would you pay money for it?
Yeah.
How much would you pay?
About 20 pence.
I don't know, the same plus as the standard, there you go.
Thank you. Would you pay any money for it?
No.
No. No. All right.
No.
Not really.
Not really?
No.
Free sheets are OK if you need something to read on the train, and they have captured a rare commodity, younger readers. But they can't cover things in depth. The future for delivering this content to the next generation is online.
Young people want choice. Everybody wants choice. And thanks to the personal computer, people are taking charge of their own lives. And they read what they want to read or what they're interested in. And young people today are living on their computers.
After a slow start, most newspapers are now embracing the web as a platform for reaching readers.
We are totally neutral. About whether you read it on your television screen or you read it on your BlackBerry. We are the providers of information and opinion, and we hope that we're the ones that people will come to.
I think the printing presses we bought about 4 years ago may well be the last printing presses we ever buy. If that sounds gloomy, I don't think it is, because I think as a news organisation, people are going to need news. And I think we will provide it as well, if not better than ever before. The product of print on paper, I think its days may be numbered.
This digital revolution means a more demanding readership and a less loyal one. Today, people want to see the news as it's happening. They want pictures, video, audio, opinion and analysis at the click of a button. And if they can't find it on your website, they'll simply go elsewhere.
It's all happening at once. And you either think that's the most exciting time ever to be a journalist, or it's so frightening that you want to put your head under the duvet.
So let's take the Daily Telegraph. It's Britain's biggest selling quality daily, and it's about as traditional as a newspaper gets. Can a posh paper like this turn itself into a serious player in the online world? The Telegraph thinks it can. It's overhauled its working practices and moved into new high-tech offices. Online wizard Edward Roussel agreed to show me round.
So what you can see here is that we've sort of projected images of the website up against the wall. We've got images of the video that we make up against the wall. It's trying to send a message to the newsroom floor that we are a digital company as well as a newspaper company. And then there's something that's quite fun there, which is that there's a table that shows what's being read in real time.
So up there, people down here can see exactly what people are reading on the internet. So if you've written some lofty opinion piece and no one's reading it, it must be a bit demoralising.
You can be a bit red-faced, yes, and that does obviously happen. It also has created a little bit of competition, which we quite like, so people can compete for space. Over here you've got a video studio, which again, not something that you would have seen in a newspaper group a few years ago, but we're making more and more video.
And this week we're going to look at the world's largest economy and the effect of the new president, Barack Obama.
Now, as someone who's worked in newspapers, you know, all their working life, I've always envisaged the typical Telegraph reader, someone who's lives in the countryside, old, bit posh. Now, are you trying to change all that?
No, we are very dedicated to those readers, and that is part of our readership, but it isn't all of our readership. We have a very large metropolitan younger audience that follow our content also on the web. So the challenge is to be able to deliver the content that the metropolitan audience wants and the rural audience wants. And what you find very often is that they're not so different after all.
But for all its futuristic allure, there is a big problem with online publishing.
I'm sure if all newspaper proprietors tomorrow could press a button and the whole digital thing would never have happened, they press that button.
The trouble with new media is that they are distinctly unprofitable. There's probably only about one website in the UK developed by newspapers that is profitable.
That's because practically no one, even those of us who love newspapers, seems prepared to pay money to read them online. Free news sites like the ones from the BBC and MSN all have a big impact on newspapers' web pages.
I think people have an attitude of, if it's online, we should have free access. It is an environment where, of course, there is a high level of free access. And I think that does colour the ability of organisations to charge for content.
So newspapers have to move online at a time when they can't yet make much money out of the internet. But it's not all bad news. In the future, the digital age will provide real opportunities.
Out of our 20-odd million unique users a month, two-thirds of those are abroad. So it's roughly a third in Britain, or a third in North America, and a third in the rest of the world.
Almost 7 million people a month log on to The Guardian's website from America, and it's not the only British paper that's attracting readers here. The workers in this New York design company regularly log on for their news. Some of them are British expats, some are Americans, and some from even further afield. They all like British news.
People tend to send you links for things like The Independent and The Guardian, interesting stories, so I get a lot of that. Then if I need to get business news, especially specific stuff about companies, I get that from the FT.
From time to time, I look at The Guardian.
The Times or The Guardian.
I get little bits emailed to me, like, you know, breaking news stories. They email them to me whenever they happen. I've been getting lots about the economy recently.
These workers are the kind of people advertisers want, but because they're reading it in America, it's pointless advertising British-based products to them. Cameron Yule runs a global ad company that's done deals with The Telegraph, The Guardian and The Independent. He says they need to change the way they think about their readership.
Newspapers of old have been based around how far a truck can drive from a printing press. That's the distribution, that's the market. Today the market is as wide as the World Wide Web, it's global. So for a newspaper to make money, they've got to sell to that global audience, and that's what they've got to figure out how to do, and quickly too.
Cameron is helping his British clients make money from their global readers using region-specific advertising.
Let's imagine there's a reader in Beijing reading thetelegraph.co.uk. What we want to do is serve them an ad that's relevant to their life in Beijing, not an ad relevant to someone sitting in London.
The Guardian has ambitious targets in the US. They estimate if they manage to triple their readership there, they could hit the big time as a global newspaper.
Do you then start getting on the radar of American advertising agencies, in which case you're into a very big market indeed, you know, the biggest, most wealthy market in the world? But not just America, but India, in time, China and the emerging countries and economies.
The digital revolution doesn't just provide opportunities for papers to make more money out of advertisers. A range of new devices could mean new ways of making money.
I don't think it's available in England yet, but there's a wonderful new machine here put out by Amazon called the Kindle. You can store 6 books in it or 10 books in it, or you can have a newspaper subscription on it, and you get every word of the newspaper. You can get the Wall Street Journal there or the New York Times or whatever, and you pay a subscription rate. And it is mobile. You don't need to plug it into anything. It comes by over the airwaves.
So newspapers are going through a very difficult time. They have to find the funds to weather the economic recession and at the same time be able to invest in all the digital opportunities. Not all of them will make it.
There's going to be consolidation, adaption and extinction. There will be blood on the streets. For some newspapers, it'll be over for some.
But that doesn't mean all of them are going to disappear.
I mean, many people say newspapers are going to die. I don't think newspapers will die because they are the best way, or one of the best ways, along with TV, of reaching large sections of the population. That's not going to go away.
There's no doubt that younger people are reading fewer traditional type newspapers. And that's not to say they won't read new ones. Look, the world is changing, and it's up to newspapers to adapt to that.
Our appetite for news is not diminishing. But if newspapers are to survive, they will have to embrace the media revolution. Next week in our Media Revolution series, Libby Potter investigates the book business.
Books have been cheap, they're fabulously discounted, they'll be delivered to your house the next day. What's not to like?
And the second in the series of three programmes is at 10 o'clock next Thursday here on BBC Two Scotland. Coming up next, Newsnight.